Okay, it is a pleasure for me to be with you and to share my research since 20 years on European integration. Why? Because one of the most common criticisms against regulationist approach is you are national state-centered. But as soon as you observe with the single market, with the Lisbon Treaty, with Lisbon Strategy, with the euro, you realize that you need to insert national state into European order and world order. So what I will present today is an extension of regulation theory in the case you don't have any...
Because they have your...
Oh, my Lord!
Okay, so okay, it's the first seminar, so let's say that.
But it's too little for me, so, okay, so I always say trade-off. Okay, no, tell me.
I have a big picture for me. Yes,
okay?
I can.
it's difficult, don't you?
Wait. Ils sont où les réglages?
And I think that when you have a new phenomena, the normal tendency of theoreticians is to try to apply old theories. And I will mention two old theories, the second transparency.
No.
Okay. what is to say? Is the crisis of euro so severe? In the first part of the crisis, it was nevertheless than a Latin American or Argentina crisis, in the sense, full capital mobility, fixed exchange rate with euro, and public deficit. It is Krugman's type one crisis. There is nothing to see. Oh, wonderful. So the theory is complete. At the other extreme, you had politicians about furor federalism. No money without state, no state without citizenships. Therefore, the euro will collapse. It is the normal American way. And I will go in between. Because I think that European integration calls for new issues to be addressed to. And therefore, it is very important to try to adapt. Perfect.
Like this?
Okay, perfect. Therefore, and what is very important to understand is that if euro was bound to fail, how to explain the very successful first decade? If you have a plane without a motor, it crashes immediately. So first of all, you have to analyze the historical pattern. First a success, and then the crisis, which is exactly the topic of regulation theory. We want to understand with the same analytical framework, both success and failure. And second element, if you want to become famous, I will never be famous, because I cannot adopt monocausal. Inflation is always and everywhere monetary creation. Schumpeterian radical innovation explained US. You have one single idea and you go all over the theory. The charm of regulation theory is to repel normative issue. The world should be this and this and then it will be perfect, devoid of crisis. But trying to understand national trajectories as they develop. So the big change, and I will, it is the next gap, it is first, we should repel the concept of equilibrium, especially the Varoussian equilibrium, in which all prices do adjust everything. When I'm looking at the reform of the labor law in France, most of the people think that if you remove of institutions, then you have a normal wage formation and so on. So in a sense, you go back to equilibrium. You don't understand why it took one century to build a labor code. No, it's not. Let's go back to the fundamentals. Wonderful. And then you misunderstand anything what you want to understand. Whereas my concern is about independent, interdependent social, political and economic process. The third feature of regulation theory, it is impossible to have a pure economic theory. And on this issue, I will praise the book by André Orléans. You need a monetary unit, but monetary unit needs the sovereign state, even if you have private money creation. So in a sense, you do institute things, and of course, you institute a constitution, you institute relation with the world economy and so on. So the big important thing is to study processes and not simply equilibrium. And you understand why it is so important. Second, in conventional theory, you have a wonderful equilibrium, and then you have stochastic shocks. The crisis of Lehman Brothers, oh no, let me, the most silly interpretation I ever heard. In UK, you had a decline of productivity in the building sector. Therefore, you have a negative impact, and therefore, you have a financial crisis. Wonderful, so extraordinary. So you have everything was perfect. And it is totally silly. The loss of productivity comes from the lack of effective demand in the construction sector. And since you have an employment cycle, you have a decline of productivity. The charm of the theory is to take the cause for the consequence as the consequence of the causes. For me, it is totally amazing, this kind of success to me. So you see, understand why I will never become famous, because I'm totally opposed to the normal way of doing things. Third, I admire my fellow. None of them had studied before the oil crisis, open integration, and brutally went from day to another. When I look into BFM, to Antenna, all of them became specialists of open integration. But de facto, they were specialists of variation model, Schumpeterian models, post-Keynesian model, but they are not specialists. You need to understand the historical process before you speak. So you are entitled to speak when you understand the world process of the emergence of European integration, because then you can locate the problem. If not, you compare a really existing economy to an abstract optimum, which nobody has never so you see, it's wonderful, you are very clear. Unemployment, labor market rigidity, trivial in my model. But why one century of trying to organize, for example, minimum wage? Fourth point, you need absolutely collective actors. What bothers me in the new classical theory, you have only atomistic actors, representative actors, and one representative actor is doing the American economy. Ah, this is nice. You have no Wall Street, no Federal Reserve, no big firms, you don't have Apple. So you have a purely individual. You absolutely need collective actors. What is the argument? First, I'm very amazed by the fact that when I was young, the central banker or the Minister of Finance were politicians. Now they tend to be trained economists. Look around the world. And so what I discovered studying the euro crisis is that the role of economic ideas from economic theorizing, and I will try to argue that in Europe, a part of the problem comes from the fact that we fall in love with dynamic, stochastic, general equilibrium models, where in the Federal Reserve in US, they are much more pragmatic. These models are not leading. In France, we're more royalist than the more fond of the king than the king himself. And this has played a role in the genesis of the crisis. Second, you had a competition, and I was part of it, and I was totally defeated back in the end of the 90s. You had Schumpeterian, you had Keynesian, you had post-Keynesian, you had Marxist, and you had Galatians. The winner was the variations, which is very important. But if you look at all the other approaches, all of them were detecting the fact that euro was not viable. But the only winning theory has been the people saying it will be viable via the wonderful idea of rational expectation. Since the euro is reversible, everybody will do anything to make it viable. Interesting, no? Okay. Then what is very interesting also is we are living a totally technocratic vision of Europe. When you read the memorandum of understanding applied to Greece, you have 43, the government should do this, a recipe, and therefore the task of the government is to implement the optimum policy determined by experts. You are totally rid of any political process, whereas what is very important, euro was a purely political process. Fourth, what is very important, public deficit were not so important in the case of Europe. The big theme I will develop is that capital mobility has been hiding the internal disequilibrium about Europe. So in a sense, had not existed full mobility of capital toward Greece, toward Spain, and so on, you would not observe the same intensity of the crisis. And everybody is looking at the public deficit. You should look at the financier and the redeployment. Why it is so important? Because when you have the crisis, the implicit power of financier is designing the condition of the world of the crisis. It is not purely a question of public finance. Fifth element, people do like black and white, good and bad, and so on. And so the discussion frequently is, will the euro collapse definitely, totally, and then we go back to the national state? Or will we have a wonderful federalist Europe? In the reality will be, trust me, in your existing life, not only mine, it will be in between. So again, we need to have imagination. The intellectual origins are clearly the victory of new neoclassical theory is impressive. First, Greek people fall in love with leisure. Brutally, in Spain too, they were working hard. And brutally, you have a shock of leisure because all employment is voluntary, except to have laborers. Second, you have an helicopter pouring money. Oh, it's interesting, because when you go to the bank, you have a credit, you have the undergraduate credit. Nice, okay. Third, symmetric shock or not symmetric shock, since the only moving is the symmetric shock. So provided you have symmetric shocks, euro will function. But what is very important, even a symmetric shock, given different regulation, gives different trajectories. Whereas in this model, you have nearly the same model from Tanzania and US. Wonderful. We have the same model for Greece and Germany. Perfect. But the same shock with in Tanzania or in Greece and Germany do not lead to the same phenomenon. Fourth, politicians are rational. They know they sign a treaty, and we will do everything to comply with the treaty. Have you ever seen a politician trusting they win election by making promise, and then they hope that the people, the citizen, will forget? So, for example, for banks, you can imagine that the irreversibility of euro makes change of choice. But for politicians, the game is the same, the national game, to win the next election. So the euro has not been a big change. It was simply part of the game. And rational school was saying everybody has to comply with the final point, and the final point is the viability of euro. A fifth element, the same size for all. Wonderful. We are all equals with minor variation. So Greece is Germany less competitive. But if you make it more competitive, we can reach. Wonderful. You imagine when you start with this vision, this crisis is a total mystery. So understand why the European Commission was silent during 6 months. This should not happen. What is happening? Why is something wrong? And what is very important, let's go. You had alternative interpretation. And I was on the bad side of this. With my colleague Colin Crouch, we published the aftermath of the euro. 2000, Oxford University Press. And all the people have been anticipating that the euro was not viable. Okay, it was the demo. And you, I'm very proud of the demonstration. You can read. It is, I do not subtract anything. But we are defeated. You had Keynesian. Keynesian was impressed by the fact that with the stability and growth pacts, you had a limit on public spending. And for them, they were anticipating a kind of deflationary. They were forgetting that with financial liberalization, credit was compensating the fact that you have a public deficit constraint. Schumpeterian theories. The name of the game is to have either radical innovation or marginal innovation in order to sustain increasing incomes per capita. So in this model, you had the idea with the stabilization of exchange rate, you had a premium to open a factory in Germany and to open an hotel in Greece. Hotels do have the ability to generate reserves in euro, but you understand that the marketability of the two are totally different in terms of employment. So you have a strong specialization, and in some case, you need a complementarity, you know, just to compensate. If division of labor is organized at the open level, you need all the compensatory mechanisms to stabilize this new division of labor. New economic geography by Krugman was very nice. You will have a huge concentration of innovation centers or local specialization, not at all the diffusion of the same standard of living and production standards all over Europe. And last but not least, post-Keynesian theory was stating that be careful, we are in time of financial deregulation. And one major phenomenon to be monitored was the stability of the banking and financial system. So they were pointing a real issue. Be careful, we need to take care. And all these enterprises, and you have another one, specialists of public finance. Very nice. Econometrician forecast that most of the countries, in the absence of change, would be unable to comply with the stability and growth path. So it was very easy. You make economy. Of course, again, the rational school say, but they know they should not break the pact. Therefore, they will try. You have political economy say that public spending, tax system, are the consequence of political alliance. It's not because I subscribe a treaty of the euro, but the political process generating the tax code. So in a sense, the main determinant of public choice are not the compliance with economic rationality, but the fact that gaining electoral majority when you have election, or legitimacy if you don't have election. So clearly all these schools were forecasting that the fact you would have a crisis. And we were defeated. It is why in my next book, that we published, alas, only in French, but I hope to have translation in any language, you have a special chapter on the following question. Do we have a theory to explain the ideas that triumphs in periods? You have a spectrum of analysis. Can I anticipate the reason for which one will be winning? And it is, it is 70 pages long, so I will not summarize. But it is very important to understand this phenomenon. When you say economists were silent, of course, in the media, we are blocked. The opinion was, for example, I was rejected from experts from European Parliament because I was supposed to be an ideologue after my paper showing that euro will not be coherent. So in a sense, the voice was totally destroyed, which explains the apparent silence. All the economists went wrong. Yes, because they closed the profession. An economist was a guy able to make a reasoning in the famous dynamic stochastic general equilibrium. So with other ones were philosophers, sociologists, amateurs, and ideologues. Then could we anticipate the crisis? Of course, because if you take from the founding textbook in macroeconomics, one of the very earlier Nobel Prize, where it was not ideology, but real contribution to economics, John Tibergen. Clearly, if you have four objectives, which are supposed to be inflation, full employment, external equilibrium, and growth, you need four instruments. And in the national state, you have all these instruments. Monetary policy to curb down inflation, full employment, the mix of them, full employment via taxation or public spending, external equilibrium via the political choice of an exchange rate regime, which was a political device, you can select it. Fourth, you have innovation or industrial policy. So you understand clearly, with a normal model, you have all the tools. When you shift to, follow, I will come back to the, no, sorry, I will go directly, because time is elapsing quickly. Then let's imagine the regulationist interpretation. by definition, you are removing three tools to the national states. The first one is the monetary regime. And when you look carefully, the policy decided by Mr. Draghi pleased nobody. For some, it is too strict. For others, it is too laxist. And I'm a student of mine. I've been studying full time. The fact that the policy is never adjusted, even for the German. By chance, some country is just the median country. But first, therefore, you are losing monetary. It is disadjust. Therefore, you need more action on the wage labor index. If you look carefully all the statements by central bankers, you have to since the monetary policy cannot be used for the normal Keynesian full employment, you need to have flexibility of wage, flexibility of employment, so clearly you have a big change in the fact that the wage labor compromise was central to Fordism, is dissolved into the fact now it has to be coping with the transformation of all institutional forms. Nature of competition. Even in the case of Germany in the good times, you have oligopolistic competition in spite of authority governing competition. Now, with the fact that you create the single market, one division of the European Commission is taking in charge the fact that, for example, merger and acquisition do not change competition and so on. So the nicely collusion between Ministry of Finance and leading firms is destroyed by the fact that you have a higher level. The degree of competition is higher, and regulations operate at the level of Europe. Fourth, the exchange rate, which, by the way, is determined by nobody, because really the central bank has not the charge of doing so. Implicitly, the gathering of Ministry of Finance do have, but the floating exchange rate, euro-dollar, is the adjusting mechanism. Contrary to the fact that in the past, of course, before liberalization, you had the ability to decide. Let me give you a wonderful anecdote about why the exchange rate is a political device. I have a wonderful issue of journal Le Monde, which states France devaluate the francs. But France did not devaluate because at the last minute, General de Gaulle decided not to devaluate. It was very interesting because all the economists were thinking, it's for sure. And de Gaulle said no, which is a wonderful example. The choice of an exchange rate is a political choice. It is a mystification to figure out it's part of the market. Of course, if you create liberalization of markets, you are prisoner of the markets, but you can resist. And last, fifth element, the state has to be well governed in order to attract capital, to curb down inflation. So you have to comply. Therefore, you have been losing most of the instruments who made the golden age, high speed growth, reduction of inequality, and nearly full employment. So you understand that you enter a totally new era. And what bothers me, it was in most macroeconomic textbooks coming from US, you still have a closed economy. Imagine how relevant it is, given this interwinning, I don't know, the how to call this, the interconnectedness, no, the fact that you have the lower level and the super level are linked one with another, so like a millefeuille. I don't know what is the name in English. Then we have no theory, no macroeconomy theory adapted to this. And it is what is frightful. When you have a crisis, you don't have the tools to. Let me introduce the team. The diagram you need, the diagram is not very good, but let me explain why it is important. Against the same size for all, you have three distinctive features that distinguish economies. The first one, I will insist very much, the degree of structural competitiveness. Understand that your ability, without the single market, to be competitive on the world market. And you understand how crucial it is in time when direct foreign investment is totally free, where you have full capital mobility. Then you have your degree of control of finance. Because in a sense, you have, for example, you take China before the last 5 years, you had the total control of capital intro, and it changed a lot, for example, exchange rate regime. And last factor, the ability of the state to monitor the economy, to recover taxation. And then you see clearly that you have two Europes at this level. Germany, Finland, Netherlands clearly are both competitive, structurally competitive via innovation. For example, you continue to have a very specific organization of banks giving credit to small-sized manufacturing firms. You still have a wonderful control of the credit in the German case, after some hesitation to go the American way. And you have a very effective state, as manifested by the turnaround of Mrs. Angela Merkel on the question of nuclear plants or the question of migration. You have an operative state. When it changed, it changed, okay. Right. Contrary, when you go to Portugal, Greece, Italy, and Spain, you had problem of competitiveness. You had problem of regulation. For example, the Central Bank of Spain let develop a wonderful real estate bubble. So in a sense, yes, not that in Germany you had no bubble, no real estate bubble, contrary to all other countries. And of course, what is very important, in the case of Greece or of Turkey, you have a very weak state. The state is simply the expression of the compromise which redistributes the benefit of the public budget. The macroeconomic concern for the Greek economy is nearly absent. So you have, and in between you have France, which should be the broker between North and South. But since I give you my hint, fundamental is from an economic point of view, the French should ally to the South. But for respectability, they want to ally to the North. But we have not the productive system which entitles us. The outcome is the strong deindustrialization, unemployment, because we are in between, and both Sarkozy tried, no, Jospin tried once. Then Sarkozy tried, they came back. Hollande tried, and they came back. And you see, even for the migration problem, France sticks to the north in terms of political reform. They are killing the competitiveness of French economy. You understand why I'm so pessimistic? I never speak about France because I'm too sad. I prefer to study Japan, Korea, Brazil, and so on. All of them are in crisis, but I'm not a citizen of it. So you understand one theme which is opening. Euro was supposed to unify Europe. Is de facto organizing diverging trends. You had heterogeneity, but you deepen the heterogeneity, and the North refused fiscal solidarity. You understand that there is a big problem. And I'm very pleased by the migration problem, not pleased about the poor people, but because it opens clearly the fact that you have a pure conflict between interest, Europe as an entity, and Europe as the conjunction of national-centered compromise. And we see the limits of this method. Third theme. Yes, I will be nearly in time. Okay. I am amazed how technocratic the European Commission has become. I've been reading the memorandum of understanding of 11th of August this year, and then you have citizens are mentioned 5 times. International expert, one best way, are quoted 15 times. So the justification of the model is everybody knows that this is good. Citizens do not count in the compromise. In the sense, you're having replacing political deliberation by expertise of experts. And this expertise is false. The drama. Sometimes, for example, if I build a bridge, I trust nearly. Some bridges do collapse, but very infrequently. When I trust Mr. Sommer for deregulating the derivative products, I'm not sure that it is directly derived from a perfect knowledge of finance. So the third theme is very important. It says the political legitimacy has totally been forgotten, and this comes from very long. If you read Jean Monnet's memoirs, the idea is that politicians are blocked by their political constituency. But experts can take decisions that are initially hidden to the citizen. Well, when I open the market for steel and coal, maybe the unionists of the steel sector do comply, but complain, but not the job. And due to this expertise, you begin a process according to which you will deepen the integration via the fact that technocratically, Germany and France are economically dependent, and therefore, we have to forge the institutions, the political institutions, to accompany. And in a sense, the functionalism is replacing the political deliberation. And you understand when you have the crisis of the euro, you need deliberation because functionalism collapse. So in a sense, you have, and in a major sense, a structural crisis of foreign integration because the way, I will put it afterwards, because the method they used to overcome the conflict among national states are exhausted. They cannot function on the euro, which put the political issue at the core. Second, now, what do we observe? This is a survey, public opinion survey, 97. I'm very proud of this. It is back in my paper on 2000. Firms and young people were enthusiastic about the euro. Small shopkeepers, savers, people with low incomes, and old people were afraid by the European integration. And it is very important, is that how we organized a pluralistic debate in the case of France. In 1999, in Commissariat General au Plan, you had a series of three reports organizing the discussion of constitutional law, social law, economic integration, and so on. But the people involved in this was many experts from the public administration. You go to Sweden, and due to Calmfors, who is a famous Swedish economist, they organized a systematic review of the likely impact of the euro for farmers, fishers, nurses, education, university, mobility, and so on. They organized all the groups. And you have all the results of the groups. And the outcome was the following. We are winning uncertain gain of pooling sovereignty, but we are losing our social and economic sovereignty. Therefore, we do not take the risk of the euro, which is a very interesting one. Because this was replaced by symmetric shock and rational expectation will make you efficient. When I put a contrast with, okay, we have a single monomaniac. Here, you review all the impacts. And the gain were uncertain, and the constraint were certain, and restricting autonomy. The same reasoning from the Danish. Danish people thought, if we join the euro, it will be a direct pressure on our very developed welfare. So in essence, you see the point. Exchange rate stability is good, but we have to assess what are the consequences overside. And if you have two mixed results, by democratic deliberation, you decide, I don't go. Imagine that the same debate could take in France, and what the referendum 2009, for example, the euro would have been repelled by the French people and the Dutch people. So in a sense, you understand clearly that the lack of democracy is now to be paid, because for the first time, you ask to people what are your opinions, and they have been betrayed by the fact that technocratically it will be good. I'm sorry for the complex diagram, a simplified version in the publication, but why it is so difficult to become European? Because you change many things. You change financial regulation, you change single market competition, you make monetary integration, and of course you have the question of public debt funding. And each of the big stakeholders, multinational, small firms, low-skilled workers, high-skilled workers are affected in a very complex mix. And then we work, the poor people are only to say yes or no, so understand how it is difficult. And most of the model in political sense, you have only one issue. You count yes, no, and you have the median elector. the big complexity of the RIO is that you have to vote on a complex mixed set of issues. And the big drama is if you make a vote or referendum, you have to be sure that the people in favor of the integration win over the other one. And I'm very eager to see the British referendum. It will be very nice. because it is very uncertain. Because these interests are defined by the deliberation, by the fact to present them. I would be unable to make this analysis for France detailed, because it is really. So you have a kind of subjectivity. And therefore, what has been very, very interesting, you have been, this is too complex, let's go along the functionalist way. Euro is good for you because it stabilizes exchange rate, it augments growth, it creates more employment, more wealth. So you simplify technologically. In a sense, you are Pareto improving. So we don't care about deliberation. And why the situation is very, very uncertain. On one side, the federalists do think that since most of the issues are dealt in Frankfurt, Strasbourg, or Luxembourg, and all the European agencies, you will imagine to create a political constituency at the level of Europe. So in a sense, the economic sphere is driving political life. You organize political life along Europe, and there, progressively, you work out a new alliance of modernism. But it was the mirage, okay, the crazy dream of the federalists that smoothly. The other one is we are losing all our tools of control of the national economy. Most of the population is hurt, the low-skilled worker, welfare dependent, small firm, and so on. And therefore, you have a general demand for renationalization of policy. For example, the case of Britain is let's renationalize most of the policy, the Schengen, the mobility, the agricultural policy, and so on. And therefore, the big struggle you see today is nearly defeated federalist, because the political arena is not here, and winning nationalism, we should recover most of the instrument of sovereignty. And this was simply the neglect of the building a constituency able to do. And last but not least, here comes the fallacy of a technocratic approach. I was very amazed when politicians meet in the summit. And for the most important decision, you need unanimity. And when they came back to their national capital, they decided, I guess. So in a sense, Europe has been used as a liberalization device, blocked at home, but saying, it's not me, it is Europe. When the system collapsed, it backfired. Therefore, Europe is a plan for going to a free market economy. And so you should understand clearly that this use of, as a constraint of Europe, which was de facto built by international elite, then you get the normal way. But of course, we will not follow. Bruxelles is liberalization, is not a construction of a national policy. So you understand clearly why you have a boom of Europe. When I will, the next section will develop this on the question of Eurozone. And then the crisis, because the very arrangement that entitles you to legitimate the process collapse with the crisis of the euro. I'm very fond of looking at this. Imagine you had, for example, a German chancellor meets a French president of the Republic. For the German, the core argument is to create a legal order in order anybody not to have negative externality on others. The French president of Republic want to introduce in Bruxelles the French Republic with a strong interventionism in social law, fiscality, and so on. So they agree on something, but they have totally distinctive vision. Then the second diagram, Delors meets Thatcher. Oh, wonderful. The single market. For Thatcher, it is a way of destroying labor unions, organizing competition, and so on. For Delors, it is a method in order to promote the next step, which would be a social Europe and a political Europe. And this gives the single market treaty. So you understand, again, the question. You have two forces, Oh, what a wonderful compromise. You follow up, and the forces do diverge. And we are living a period where converging forces now diverge. But it's not a novelty. It is simply the continuation of the mechanism, in a sense, ambiguity. You can read a book by Nicolas Jacquot, for example. Ambiguity has been at the core of the compromise. You have a kind of peace treaty, but the struggles continue. And as soon as you have unemployment and so on, you have a backfire from firms and so on. So again, you understand better the continuity in the evolution. So it's not you have a large continuity in the way the Europe is organized. Then, it is a survey, 97. I was amazed by this survey. Generally, I don't trust survey, but just for the, because I was trained by Bourdieu. And so, according to the way I put the question, do I like Europe? Is Europe, because I can twist, I go from 30% to 70%. So clearly, I can destroy this. But nevertheless, let me. A clear ability of the Southern Europe, and France belong, people were enthusiastic. For Spain, it is modernization. The Portuguese are, because you have dictatorship, you go to Europe and you have democracy and growth. So you have strong adhesion to the euro. And in the north, people do doubt, for example. The people in Netherlands, in Great Britain. The big drama is the following. All the economies with structural competitiveness problem love Europe, the euro. And the people able to prosper in Europe don't like it. Je t'aime, moi non plus. It is very, very important in order to understand. You see the point. So in a sense, you have a fold, a love affair. I love it, but I cannot sustain it. I could sustain, but I don't love you. And you understand, and this is back to 79. So this is why it's so important to understand history. You have permanent features, which are, and you have to detect them. And then you understand better the evolution. Then that's my favorite theme, because nobody has read this book, but I'm very proud of it. Will financier destroy capitalism? Because I think the big mistake is that the liberal public opinion has been the laissez-faire, because liberal has a different meaning in America language, has convinced public opinion that private is always efficient, public always inefficient. The big drama is that, do you know why in the Obamacare, the Massachusetts scheme, which was a kind of universal, unique, obligatory insurance healthcare system, was repelled because it was more efficient than the private one. what is very interesting, be careful, in some case, you have more efficiency in the sense that, why? Because you are saving a third of the health insurance is devoted to making advertisement, devoted to attract people from the other pension healthcare funds. So in a sense, you are gaining 30% by the fact that it's obligatory. You cannot discriminate risk. So clearly, why the crisis was so severe? Because financial liberalization was supposed to be a minor phenomenon. It's not a minor. Big question is the public deficit. This is important. No, the action was taking place in the financial sector. And I was always very, very, very surprised by the fact that, as you know, the most talented people of you used to go to Wall Street, to the city, and so on, because first they earn 4-5 times what we earn as academics. So clearly you have the most clever people are in. And when I saw the rate of interest of the secondary market to refinance Greek, Spanish, Portuguese, and German bonds. As you know, before the euro, you have incredible inflation in Greece, you have to pay nearly 25%, and in Germany, you are only 7%. As soon as you announce the adhesion of Greece, financiers do think that the viability of the Greek debt is equivalent to the German one, which is a very impressive one, because the capacity to pay tax, to organize legality, the specialization, and that they have the same rate of inflation. Or imagine that, as you know, inflation was lower in Germany because it was specialized in traded goods, whereas it was very higher in the case of the service economy of Greece. And this was supposed that, okay, 1 euro invested in Greek public spending had the same efficiency and quality as the German one. For me, it was the proof of total irrationality, because at the same time, you have a famous item of the European Treaty: no foreign state is entitled to bail out another national state, because this was supposed a total solidarity. I know we have differences, but the value is the same. So the big mistake of financiers has been to taking for granted the fact that the stabilization of exchange rate is a necessary and sufficient condition for the fact that all public treasury bonds have the same value, which is totally totally false, given the divergence of rate of inflation and the various degree of inability to recover taxes. And what is very important, and again, you have the dichotomy of monetarism. In the monetarism, as you know, in the medium term, monetary is neutral. Whereas with the euro, look at the left-hand diagram. You had a decline of manufacturing sector in the south, and a wonderful performance of Germany and Ireland, which is the platform of multinational capitals. And conversely, the other diagram, in the case of Spain, you have a huge increase in the service sector. So you have a strong, in the sense, the south is specializing in service. Some of them are traded, but most of them are not. Whereas the north is specialized in the manufactured goods, and the direct consequence is clearly, you know perfectly, the fact that you had a surplus due to Germany, entitled to finance the deficit, and via the target mechanism in which you have monetary integration, you have a recycling of euro gained by that. But what is very important in this case, you are organizing the productive divergence of the south and the north, which is organized, which was very important, but still more it is. And what is very, very, very important, since in the past, the Chinese have an exchange rate policy to peg to the dollar. The US has autonomy in the use of dollar as a tool for economic policy. The yen was declining as a reserve currency. Therefore, the only way of adjusting the world economy was the ratio of euro versus the dollar. Given the fact that in the early beginning, Americans thought that the euro will collapse. So you have a strong devaluation before the pas of the euro. And then you have an appraisal, which exerts a competitive pressure on Greece, Portugal, Spain, are specialized in goods in which the elasticity of exports to unit labor price is very important. So again, you have another feature. Since the exchange rate is not an economic policy tool for Europe, you let the appreciation, and this appreciation exacerbates the divergence of productive sector. And then the divergence is income level, because if you specialize in high-tech industry like the North, or in low-skilled, low value added services, you understand that you can only live by the transfer of public structural funds of Europe or by credit. Therefore, what is very, very important, and here again, this diagram is very important, because observe that Spain and Ireland had a budget surplus. Because why have they budget surplus? Because you have such a boom in financial assets that even if you tax them moderately, you have a surplus. By the very boom, you have endogeneity of the fact that when you have a big boom like in Ireland and Spain, even if you have low taxation of capital, it was the same case at the end of Clinton's years. You tax very low, but you have such a boom. And therefore, what is very interesting, what is the medicine of the European Commission for Spain? To cut public deficit, because by automatic stabilizer, as soon as you have a collapse of growth, you have a huge deficit. But observe the big difference with Greece, which has been cumulatively, and Portugal, unable to fulfill with growth and stability pact, whereas in the case of Spain and the deficit were the consequence of this ending up of the credit-led bubbles. And again, what is very important, of course, you rescue the Spanish bank, but you continue to think that the way out is not to solve it, to create a demand for the housing, the excess of housing, but it's to cut down people in the teaching sector, in the healthcare, in the research, which is totally absurd because they have not been part at all of the debt. And again, you understand the force of ideas. Some ideas are very false, but they do exert some. And of course, when the financiers wake up brutally, and again, I urge you to read a wonderful paper by André Orlean, it's my favorite. Either financial markets do sleep and don't see the danger, or they are so upset that they think that the end of the world is coming. So in a sense, you sleep, and then brutally you impose 18% of interest rate to Greece. You never had the long-term price of in a Vixieland model. You see, for example, you would say 5% per annum would be the normal rate of growth. No, you never have this. You have much lower. And why it is so dangerous? When you have 4% of rate of interest, you have interest of using leverage effects. You go to borrow. Your rate of return of capital is 5%. 5 minus 4 equals 1. And you generate a bubble. Of course, when you have 18% of that, by definition, you are organizing the bankruptcy of the Greece government. You understand, it is self-fulfilling prophecy. You cannot, there is no viable mechanism. And again, you understand that in my reading, the responsibility has been, when the Lehman Brothers crisis comes to Europe, first, you have automatic stabilizer, but then you have cumulative deficit, and again, you have a short moment of the return of Keynes, the return of Minsky, the return of Fisher, and brutally in the summer 2010, the return of orthodoxy. We should curb down public deficit as the source of the crisis. And that's better why I spend so much time understanding. What is very, very important is that financial regulation reveals, so what is very important, so you have a dual mechanism. The mismatch of institutions in Europe and the fact that financial innovation has been hiding and then revealing the disequilibrium. You understand how dialectical it is. The euro, in the absence of financial liberalization, would have collapsed near 5 years. By financial liberalization, you postpone the mechanism, but the crisis is much more severe. And last but not least, you have to understand clearly, Greece has been a wonderful example for hiding the real responsibility. Because as you know, the successive government, both right and left, have been cooking the books, inventing the figures, having derivatives to hide. So it was clearly that they have been cheating. And for Germany, it's very bad to cheat. But this has been interpreted as the core analysis of the euro crisis, which has been hiding the structural weakness of the euro. Has been, in the Greek case, for example, you see frequently that the France will go the Greece route, you see, simply because it has been the emblematic figure representing the only part in which it's true. Public deficit has been playing some role along with financing. And what is very important, it is that the financial speculation is revealing this inconstituency. But you turn back not so much in trying to curb down financial liberalization in Europe. No. You strengthen the control by the pact, the values pact. You strengthen the growth and stability pact, and you let continue financial liberalization, which is impressive, no? In a sense, you understand better the way the world is functioning. And this is my reading. I hope I'm wrong, because I'm right, there is a big danger. I use again the idea of what was the euro. We have conflicting vision. For the legal system, in northern members, it is a strict obligation. In the case of Germany, a contract is a contract. All the line count. For sovereign contract, like maybe at the good times in Soviet Union, like stated by Jacques Sapir, it is the starting point of a negotiation. You sign something, but maybe you can renegotiate again. You understand better when the two meet. Well, it's a big problem. The contract is like, oh, no, it's just to start. Second, in the case of Northern Europe, you had what is called negotiated capitalism. Because if you are looking carefully, for example, the workers in big firms in Germany have a lot of power, much more than in France. So it's not Thatcher type or Reagan type capitalism. Whereas in the case of the south of Europe, capitalism is still a contested socio-economic regime. So in a sense, you have it in the case of Germany, where is no alternative regime. In the case of the south, there should be a crisis. It's an episode in which you can reconsider a new system. For the Germans, you have to refine the existing system. So understand when they meet, there are totally incompatible vision. Third, you have ordo-liberalism and a strong democracy. For example, when it took maybe 12 years to engineer the pension fund reforms in Germany, but when decided, it was decided instantaneously. In France, we have 2 years study, then you have the law, then you have a public demonstration, then you go back and so on, back and forth. So, whereas in the case of the South, everything is to be negotiated. No? There is no constituency in the long run about the compromise. In terms of economic dynamism, why are wage higher in the manufacturing sector for blue-collar workers in Germany? Because you have an innovation-led regime. Whereas in the South, you are still dependent of the delocalization of the Fordist mass production, which is in competition with Chinese specialization of Eastern country specialization. So again, you cannot, with the same exchange rate, you cannot sustain the same productive system. And what is the vision of Europe? Clearly, for the German, if you have no rules, it is chaos. And the chaos is political chaos, populism, and you can imagine. For the Spanish or the Portuguese, it was a way of modernizing. And if Europe is no more modernizing, we are no more European. So it was a way of modernizing political institutions and economic productive organization. And when they meet, they agreed, but with totally distinctive vision. And in crisis, of course, you are pushing one way or the other way. And the winners are clearly the northern countries who are pushing an ordo-liberalism evolution. So in a sense, in the case of crisis, you have a shifting of power. You have no negotiation between equals. And the winner is the entity able to engage credit and capital at a larger scale. Let's go to the future of the euro. I like this quotation, it's very badly translated, but you see this contradiction about migration. My argument is that why to do historical research? Just to detect structural invariance. And this is a wonderful one. Any government would like to pull its sovereignty to be stronger at the power level, but conversely does not want to apply the constraint induced by the fact we have a common policy. So in this sense, you want to take all the, I'll give you a wonderful example. The German refused their cooperative banks to be governed by the same rules of the banking union. So you see, where even Germany, the banking union is for others. For me, I want to subtract even Germany. And it is a normal way. So the rule is for others. But for me, I want to enjoy the full autonomy of the sovereign state. And you understand why this is permitting all the issues in Europe, in this sense. I want to pull, I want to control monetary equation, but I don't want to have any constraint. And this is very important phenomenon, and it gives rise to the following, excuse me, give rise to the following scenarios. My argument is that you need imagination. And you need imagination when you know one history. So what is the first scenario? I invented this scenario 2 years and a half ago, and I have no reason to change. I'm ashamed because it should be transformed totally. The first one is Mario Draghi, the rescuer of the euro. Listen, what is the only federal entity? European Central Bank. If the euro collapses, Mr. Draghi goes back to Goldman and Sachs. Whereas, if euro collapse, Mr. Boscovici go back to Mr. Finance. So you understand clearly why he's so attached. It's not European because he lost my job. And he said, hey, I'm in charge of general interest. Look, I'm not defending Germany, no. And as you have seen, he has been violating German because in the name of a la monnaie. We need to stick to the euro. Please, governments, make reform, make this. So we are still living this scenario. the last press conference of Draghi has been again. I'm here. You can trust me, euro will not collapse again. Maybe you have a recession due to China, but I'm here, I'm ready. So you understand the weakness because you have one single instrument, two, the various tools of financing and the sentence of the central banker, the central banker speaks and so on. We are still living in this scenario. But you have temptation. The Germans are not very happy with Mr. Draghi. Because clearly, when whatever it takes, he has been violating the exact term of the treaty. The justification for doing that, if you have different interest rate for Greece and Germany, then monetary policy cannot function. Therefore, I'm entitled to buy back treasury bonds in Greece in order to reduce. Clearly, this is, in legal terms, a violation. So the Germans are not happy. We are violating the rules. And tomorrow we have hyperinflation. We still have a newspaper that the next danger in Europe is hyperinflation in Germany. So you understand, and then why do we have? But the Germans have been winning in terms of the fiscal compact. They have been strengthening the conditions of the Maastricht Treaty. So in the sense of the budgetary policy in the banking union, you go along the rules, the central bankers are taking care of the existence of the euro, and the Germans are pushing the internal reform in order to make it viable. So you have a kind of dual mechanism, but the rescuer has been clearly the monetary policy. The big drama is that this makes, in the case of Greece or even Portugal, my favorite country would be Portugal, where there's no public opinion more pro-Europe than Portugal, and people suffering so much from the trocar. So then you have, if the German win, then you have, in the sense that for the first time since 7 years, you have a decline of the relative income per capita in Greece, Spain, Portugal, relative to the rest of Europe. So in a sense, you are catching up during the last 7 years, you have a decline. Therefore, people migrate from Portugal to Mozambique or sometimes to Berlin. So clearly you have this sense, in the sense you are decomposing the cohesion of the political system, and you are disorganizing the matrix of the social fabric of solidarity, which make various things. For example, you could imagine an euro for the south, an euro for the north, but the situation of Greece is not that of Spain. Spain is apparently in good shape and so on. So this gives to chacun pour soi, in the sense that the mechanism in which, and you have all the political parties, if you are looking from one election to another one, in nearly all the countries, with the exception of Germany, you have a constant rise of populists saying, we go out, we should go out of here. And then why the difference between this one? In this one, you cannot, the scenario three, you can organize the way out of euro. In the case four, it is a chaotic movement. You are, and for example, we are nearly, if Greece had exited from the euro, you should have observed a kind of spillover effect. In the case nobody knows the outcome. It depends on the intricacy of the economic, political, and financial interdependence. And therefore, here comes the British time, the British moment. I hope you know, so might be your view British, where are the most efficient think tank and network about European policy? All of them are in Britain. And since long, they have been lobbying in Europe. So most, for example, the influence of the French intellectuals in Brussels is declining. You have a huge investment of network, British-based, all over Europe, in order to design what will be possible. And since 20 years, you have the idea of a flexible Europe. Euro will not function. At the extreme, we could have a common currency, but not a unique currency. You can you keep your money, your domestic euro, and you stick with variable exchange rate. And you have a free trade zone, and Mr. Cameron will agree with Mr. Thatcher, this is what we want, a free trade zone. And if, for example, the French want to build an aircraft carrier jointly, they can do. So in a sense, you see, this is a very strong. What is the merit of this? You do not destroy Europe. You scale down Europe as a free trade zone. And then everybody is happy. The Americans say, I recognize this. Because at the early beginning, they do not understand very much the money strategy and so building. And say, oh, yes, this is a free trade zone. And it prevents the elite, the total collapse. I'm nearly finished. Look, it is just in time. Oh, yes, no, sorry. Okay. So if Cameron can be the winner, but now with the migrant and so on, with the German moves, you see how uncertain is the scenario and how the issues are complemented one with another. You understand? You cannot isolate the euro from the whole process of integration. So it depends, everything will depend on this. Here are the federalists. The most admired them is Cohn-Bendit. The national state is over. The drama. The drama is that public opinion is not gathering around the. Yes, the farmers have been gathering recently in Brussels, but in Parliament. But the big drama is that, in spite of the mild reform of our Parliament, you don't have a political consensus. Very few people, except maybe the young one, say, I'm European, and then I'm British or I'm Irish. Okay, so clearly, you have a question. And second, in time of crisis, it is too difficult to be the democratic process would be legitimizing again the intervention of Europe. So when you need democratic process, it process from one decade to decade, one century. When you need it to sustain, it's too late for the people will prefer the domestic arena of the democracy instead of, I don't know what happened, okay? Okay. I was waiting, and this seventh scenario has been proven false. I was thinking that the financiers will wake up. Why they do not wake up? Because they sold all their debt to public authority. Now the Greek debt is 85% to Central Bank, Monetary and Stability Fund, IMF, and so on. And so they're pretty quiet. Because he was thinking in the old scenario, they should have realized that the euro is not at all coherent. Let me conclude very quickly. Okay. And then, again, in the argument of a process analysis, and I will end up with. So instead of an equilibrium, we have a. For example, you have a joint theory, like I would have could design a wonderful optimum model of competence distribution. The drama is that you go from one crisis to another, like the big board. So the outcome is a dynamic process. And many dynamic processes can happen. For example, this is the first one. But you could imagine, look, what is the trajectory to be? You have exit and many cases. Oh, look, speculation is winning. Okay, no. Bank Union, yes, we agree. Clearly, you have all bifurcation, and this is a very open process. Of course, you have determinism, I pointed some of them, but you, and clearly, it is an invitation to revisit strongly capitalist dynamic process. I will stop conclusion. So, to remember, first, to be the big issue is transnationalization of regulation bots. Second, reintroduce finance and not uniquely an obsession for sound public finance. Third, studying process and their interaction and not simply ideal models. It gives a lot of space for new research, and we are very young. I hope you to be stimulated, so I will stop my conclusion here. And you can see on my website some of my products. Oh no, it's not this one. Okay, I'm sorry, but no, I took the bad, the wrong. Okay, I took the wrong. Thank you for attention, and I'm ready to hear your comments.
Thank you very much, Robert. But I don't know if I really thank you so much, because you raised so many issues that the work, my work, is almost an unfeasible task. So, tu avais refermé l'autre. Comment ça marche, ça? I don't know. Hop. Ah, David, t'as une idée pourquoi il n'apparaît pas, mon fichier? Ben, il était sur, il était ouvert tout à l'heure.
Il était quelque part sur ton bureau, toi. Sur ton.
Celui-là. Ouais. Open, open web. Open web pour quoi? Non, non, c'est bon. Attends, il doit être là. Il est là.
Ouais, il doit être quelque part, mais je sais pas où. Je vois, j'arrive pas. C'est un peu l'histoire de l'écran, là.
Attends. Attends, je vais enlever, deux secondes, ouais. Attends, sinon, ce qu'on va faire, c'est ça. C'est qu'on va fermer le PowerPoint.
Fantastic, thank you, David. So, it's okay, it's okay. So, yes, I will try to summarize what I think is the core of Robert's presentation, which in itself was quite challenging. So the aim of Robert's presentation was learning from the EU crisis, and I agree with you that we have we are living historical time, and living such historical time is a great luck for intellectual work. As Lacan used to say, the real is when it hurts, and it hurts quite seriously. So it's very interesting this moment. I agree mostly with you about the limits of the usual interpretation. Excessive public deficit, I completely agree that this idea of crowding out effect and private activity because of Ricardian equivalence is totally irrelevant. I agree also with you about the role of mismanagement of interest rate. You mentioned other explanation. The Eurozone is not an optimal currency area and thus doomed to fail. I think that this explanation is still valid. It's still not invalidated. We can explore other ways, but it's still on the table. I think we still have to demonstrate that there is a possibility to make a single European currency without fiscal federalism and democracy. So a different approach, I agree also with you. Monetary and financial instability should be related to the real economy. National heterogeneity has to be taken into account, and there is a complex web of cognitive, economic, and political factors. So, okay with the objective. My general assessment of what you have done, parting from that, is that maybe you bite off more than you can chew. At least more than I can chew, that's for sure. So I think that you are correct in refusing a monocausality, but that leads to a multiplicity of lines of arguments which are very difficult to gather. And I think that the theoretical work, and that's a definition given by the philosopher Frederick Jameson, theories are cognitive maps. And in order to be useful, they need to be manageable. And here we have, it's quite difficult. Are your lines of argument consistent with one another? Are they articulated? It's not so clear. And second thing, I think that's the consequence of that. There is a kind of mismatch between very rich and audacious developments. And on a lot of points, you are going very, very far. But at the end, you don't manage to cross. Thank you. in the world. So it's less expensive for you to expand. You have cheaper fundings for your international expansion. And we can trace this advantage of world money. If you look at FDI dynamics, here you have the net FDI stock for France, Germany, and Euro. And we observe that after the launch of the Euro, you have, in this moment, a strong increase in the net stock of FDI for this country. So transnational capital, European transnational capital, has benefited in of the Euro in terms of greater expansion worldwide. But there is also a second argument, is that the implementation of the Euro implies, and it's a way to circumvent past social compromises. There is, of course, this quote from Draghi, which is very well known: the European social model has already gone. But there is something which was already clear in Delors reports in the late 80s, that without European transfer and exchange rate adjustment, there is only wages and public spending to adjust. And so this is very class-based, this mechanism of adjustment. And so I want to here go back to my... to this. So this is one, this is 100% Robert Way. I took your paper of 1999, and we make that, and we use this in a paper just published in Competition and Change, maybe you remember about that. And so you have in the productive capital moment of the Fordist era with the hegemony of the wage-labor nexus. What does that mean to be at the top? To be at the top means to be the most important firm, the firm to which the other firms need to adjust. That's something which is very important in the regulation theory at this moment. So the most important thing was the wage-labor. So that means that for countries at this moment, the important thing was to manage labor, manage the strength of the labor movement on the one hand, and to put people to work in order to produce more. But in the 80s, you have the crisis of the 70s and so on, the dynamic changed. The more important issue was competition and trade. That's the reorganization of markets. And here the European integration is involved. You have a shift from this issue, which right now will be dealt only at the European level. And so you have a kind of hierarchy, of change of hierarchy of structural firms, and at the same moment, a change in statehood. And finally, you have the financial capital moment, which is basically the Euro and so on. And at the top right now, you have money and finance, and the other firms need to adjust. And you see that the wage labor nexus is alone at the national level, completely subordinated to the two other firms. So, to use a more conceptual word concept, it's the concept of structural selectivities. This concept was used by Poulantzas and also Karl Hofe, which are both of them are political philosophers. And so, what does that mean? This idea of structural selectivities. Structural selectivities is issue that you deal with. Kind of response that you are okay to receive, to discuss. That's exactly what you say, that you were not in the framework, so you were not relevant. Economic policy, that's a kind of selectivity. And also social actors, which are legitimate to interfere. With the building of the European Union in the past two decades, you have exclusive competencies of the EU, which are commercial policy, competition policy, monetary policy. And this policy selects very specifically which are the relevant issues and which are the people to deal with and which are the theory. And this mechanism of selectivity has a very strong effect because the solution that can emerge at the European level can only be consistent with this kind of selectivities. That's the reason why, and what is not in your paper of 1999, the possibility of a social Europe don't materialize. Here we have the theoretical reason. Because when you begin with some question, you begin with some kind of actors, some kind of responses, and the others are progressively marginalized. This was exacerbated after the crisis. We have a huge crisis, huge unemployment, 44 million of underemployed or unemployed people in Europe, and you don't have the very beginning of a European plan against unemployment. At the same time, you have more than 2 trillion euro, which have been used to rescue the financial system in various moments. So this unevenness is very striking, very spectacular, I think. Okay, we have also a negative path of social integration, because that is not that the European level don't deal with the social issue, but it only deals negatively with the social issue. That's also a kind of Hayekian argument. Hayek argues that if the federal level will intervene, it will only intervene to lower the barriers, to allow more market dynamism. So it's already a lot of things, so I stop here. But thank you very much for that.
Okay, so I was too generous today with the discussion, but won't be the same next time. Maybe we can pick up a few questions now from the floor before giving the floor to Robert Moyer again. So who wants to start with a question?
Thank you. My name is Sophia. Thank you for your presentation. And I wanted to ask, in your opinion, is the growth of Eurozone to the East an opportunity or a threat for the sustainability of the euro? Thank you.
Thanks. Just briefly, mostly for Professor Durand, regarding this argument that achieving world money for the euro was one of the sort of main interests prompting integration in the first place, which was a very nice piece of analysis to hear. But one problem with it is it would make it fairly difficult to understand Germany's role in the Greek crisis, because it sort of appears to have been revealed, at least recently, by Varoufakis' statements in that essentially the Germans were very willing to push the Greeks out. And in fact, the deal that was proposed to Schäuble at the end, you know, some people consider that actually it was meant to be something that the Greeks couldn't in fact accept. And that would have completely undermined the objective of creating the euro as world money. So if that was the case, it would suggest that there's a very bizarre degree of autonomy of the German state, or it's just not following the interests of its capital class. So I wondered if you can comment. Thanks.
Someone else now? Or we ask a few answer from... Okay. Robert?
Okay.
You, maybe you can...
Okay, okay. Okay. So thank you so much, because I a big divergence initially and then a big convergence. Let me stick to the question. Yes, my analysis is a little obsolete, because I was convinced by your work with Stockhammer on the East part and with immigration. So you have two oppositions. The euro revealed north-south. But the migration and the catching, the rapid catching of East, means that you have a complementarity at three. And then the alliance in the future will be built, probably the alliance of North and East, right, excluding the South. So you should reinforce my point of view. And I do agree that I should update. I would buy your second hypothesis about to extend to the complementarity of the East. And then you have a tentative answer. For German economy, the Eastern integration is very important, because I've been studying for that the car industry. The way it has been road delocalized in Hungary and many countries, having very effective role. And then let me a little small disagreement on the German case. They have been benefiting of two things: an overestimation of arts cut, what is the fact, wage austerity, which have been existing. But the major thing is that the innovation system of Germany has been able to keep the ability to master price formation of highly sophisticated goods. So in a sense, you add oligopolistic competition on foreign markets, declining with the catching up of other countries, with wage austerity. And it was totally unfair. My reading is that you play both games. The game of competitiveness by labor cost and innovation. And the big performance or surplus comes from the specialization of Germany. So and therefore everybody is pricing for the rest of France. Let's adopt arts cap. But no, we do not have the structure. And second, in the case of arts cap, you split. You are creating working pools. You can interpret as splitting. I've been writing on this special paper. In the sense, you stick from a corporatism. In the sense, you have weight negotiated at the sectoral level, whatever the sector. With Eastern integration, the firms are not competitive enough. Therefore, you accept wage concession in order to defend employment. And you go on, you go on, you go on, and then you've segmented workers. Core competent workers and low-skill, low-paid workers, which breaks the unity of labor movement in the case of Germany. And so, in fact, I call this a Japanization of labor relations. Because it is no more the same model. You belong to Siemens, to Volkswagen, it's good for you. You are unskilled, you are cleaning the snow in Berlin. So, and this is a major change unnoticed by the people. You don't have any more class homogeneity in Germany, which makes a very important thing. Then the unions are weak. Then you cannot imagine that the unions in Germany. So I totally agree with you. Eastern part has been playing a major role. And without my guess, without reunification, we should have a very different mechanism. The system was coherent in Germany. You have tension and so on. So the big danger would have been Americanization of German firms, whereas it has been a kind of Japanization. I contrast all the investments on competitive sectors and I organize a two-tier labor relation. And this is the message of art. And in the case of France, the elite are totally misled. They think that by adopting two-tier welfare state, we create the competitive base. A small remark on innovation. I've not been pleading. It's not my name is not Jean-Louis Beffa. I've not saying that we should have innovation at the. Each country should have developed its innovation system. No, my argument, look in my table. Oh, no, it is a very different one. I don't because it is impossible for the argument you said. What were the advantage of Portugal in the sense of what kind of innovation? It might be in, I don't know, music, novellas, you have a very broad innovation at the domestic level, you see the point. It was not replacing the domestic tool, but because you have to adjust your productivity, your ability to cope. So it is just an element. Second, I was very pleased by your last free phase, because in the chapter 5 of my next book, it's exactly the step of exactly the, I take this very old paper. Because if people, this Adji, this guy is, I think it's the opposite. So I take back. Because it, and you are totally right, competition at the world level has been an intermediate step. So you have a cumulativeness, and you justify financial liberalization by the benefit of opening to competition. So you have a very complex game, which is smoothly the configuration, and the descending of the wage-labor relation hierarchy is impressive. Because then you have to absorb, in the case of capital-based pension fund, in the case of US, all the flexibility is up to the wage labor, on employment, on wage, on welfare, on health, and so on. So clearly, you have all is piling up on the labor. So I totally agree with you. Let me ask you a question about the structural selectivity. Does it come from the exercise of power? Does it come to the ability of creating networks of alliance? Because I do agree on structural selectivity. But, and to reassure you, in the time of Delors' strategy, I was thinking that he will lose against visitation. Why? Because as Fritz is doing in Max Planck Institute in Cologne, you have destruction of borders, but in order to have a social welfare, you have to build. And to build, you need a consensus. So destruction is easy of the barriers. You have negative integration. The building assume unanimity. So in the spot, I was thinking that Delors was an idealist. It would have lost in any case. because by definition it was very, very even with social democratic movements and so on. Because you had to, so I agree with you on this issue. So, but rhetorically, you see the point. It was nice. It looks symmetrical. But de facto, it was the beginning, Mrs. Thatcher. And it is why I do trust the, if Mr. Cameron is clever, he can rescue Europe from the, in the sense that let's downgrade Europe in order to sustain something called Europe. So, yeah, so it is exactly this point, in the sense that, it's paradoxical, because people think it is German Europe. No, the German Europe is, it will split, it will ally to the East, but get rid of the South. Whereas the British, and they're very clever, they can negotiate, they can ally, you see, they can ally, they can organize, let's have a free market. And on the spot, cooperation on this issue, for example, bombing Libya, which is not a very good idea, and so on. So, okay, so having a common standard, and so on. And this is very nice, because it is very free marketer. You have free market and liberal initiative. And soft contracting, bilateral contracting. You have and you keep Europe as such. The people have done, because imagine the complete collapse of Schengen and Euro. You imagine all the elites are nearly dead. So you need to build the elites. So the British would provide the legitimacy. And it is totally paradoxical for me. I have some feeling for myself, but I'm stuck by the analysis. So for me, I was surprised to get this conclusion that the British are the key actors, which is not evident. Yeah. And we will see, wait and see. Yes, you are right. In other papers, I've been much more acute. Here, I was trying to, in this paper, it was devoted to, for example, I tested in Portugal for the first time. I would try to understand the other framework approaches. Here is my criticism and way of thinking, instead of saying the theory is built and to develop the theory. Okay. I could be sharper, as you did in the last two. So I buy you two hypotheses. If I have time, I will incorporate East, South. This is very, very important to understand. And second, the question of financial hegemony. But let me raise a question. How do we interpret structural selectivity? My argument should be the following, a very materialistic one, very Marxist one. If I'm a pension fund, or Mr. Buffett, by my expectation, I put capital, and I open some future. Of course, they have collapsed, but I'm a non-governmental organization fighting and can only invest the small sum. You see the point? So you have an equal movement. I can mobilize $10 billion in this direction, no? The NGO can invest 10 billion, okay. So first element, we say. And second, you have strong state and weak state, and this exists, I think. And Greece was not, I never thought that it was a good government, a bad government in Greece. It's totally different. The nature of the state was such that the domestic political life was the core. I've never used the bad policy. It is a logic. It is a rational policy given the Greek context. So I never did. This is a bad policy because it could mean that you have an optimum. No, it is. I just describe. It turned out to be incoherent with the long-run viability, but it was rather logical. The wait is stability full time. And then with the crisis of Syriza, wait and see. So as you see, there is some reasons, there is an attractor in this. So I don't think that you see. Okay. So the cognitive mark, you are totally right. The first remark, it is a devastating one, and you are totally right. What I present is too complex, too unfinished, and so on, and I'm always losing compared to people with very simple ideas. Okay, so, no, you are totally right. But it's difficult to make the analysis. You see, for example, the conclusion of British scenario, you see, cannot be obtained by theory, it is just struggling. You see, the point, so you go where you see the element, you see this mechanism, and so on. And I'm going to be the following, and it is not, maybe if I have time, I should write a last book on the following. Replacing equilibrium by processes. A process is the closing of dynamic mechanism through the arena of the symbolic element. And the dynamic is the interaction of various processes. And you understand the complexity. And I do trust that this is the truth. So and you can find many invariants of this. But the mixed is always original. This is why I'm always defeated. And this is the reason why. And I don't want to have simple ideas. I could make a king with for this, and so on, or prototypes, and so on. And so it is a very big challenge. First, because then you need to have very different tools, very different one, non-linear dynamics. So you have a totally different thinking. And this makes orthogonal to the training of people, even in social science. And you are totally right. We have been losing, my friends, most of them, due to the fact we are unable to get to the point. And maybe the closest to the point is Michel Glieta, but he's so sticking to feasible reforms that the inspiration from regulation is vanishing. So you make proposal, but you simplified so much that you're losing the gist of the regulation. This is what you're acting, but you're simplifying so much. You're understood by others, but you're losing the core message. So I admit your criticism. And last, I like the quotation by Wallerstein. Yes, European integration is a way of shifting barriers, borders. You shift powers. And what is very sad for the labor movement is that capital will always be more mobile than workers. And in a sense, this is the real victory of free trade, and because you organize materially. And so again, my argument with structural selectivity, two things. Some capitalists with the huge concentration of capital, financial capital, have the ability to direct. For example, Google, and so imagine with the huge cash flow of Apple, you imagine, no, they can have their own Mr. Gates as his own healthcare policy at the world level. So you go your way. And this is the unions, even Germany, have not this element. And the second, you have states able by their networking, by their surplus, by their quality of diplomacy. And so again, you see the struggle in Europe, just I'm thinking loudly. You have the might of Germany in terms of organization, manufacturing, innovation, and you have the cleverness of the British in diplomatic terms. You see the point. And so I would ask you, please develop more what you call structural selectivity, because it is my big interrogation. I want to understand this. And I hope a large part is a materialist ability to devote resources to some future. They can collapse, but you continue. So you have the ability. Whereas wage earners are unable, by consuming, by cooperatives and so on, they adapt at the margin of the system. They are unable, to direct a new way, which is cumulatively operating full time by mobilizing more and more resources. This is why you are totally right on the scale, which is very important, and this is the reason why I've been studying so intensively European integration, because it's not a minor event. It is clearly a big change. And in the sense, it is killing the first version of regulation theory, which was clearly centered on national domestic compromise in which workers could have the bargaining power of imposing. This, to me, at the world level, nearly eroded, even in Sweden, you have an erosion of this mechanism. So all the theory was very contingent to the Golden Age. We cannot pretend to have the general theory.
Yeah. So very briefly, just on structural selectivity, because there is so much things. So structural selectivity is a concept developed by Poulantzas and Hofer. And in Poulantzas' mind, the state is a strategic field. So, you know, in old Marxist ways, the state was just an instrument of power of the capital to display labor. And Poulantzas said, no, that's not that. In the course of history, various social groups built institutions because they asked some questions and so on. And there is a crystallization of all these questions, of all these apparatuses, of all the law, and so on. And this is the material basis of structural selectivities. Structural selectivities are the filter through which the reality is incorporated by the state. So the agenda which is imposed and that the state has to take into account, and the way it looks at this agenda. One thing which is very striking is in the course of the euro crisis, is 2010, is that there has been this huge social crisis, but which has never been at the agenda, really. And there has been, at the same time, big financial turbulences, which were at the agenda all the time. And if you remember, it was striking, the wording used by the government in the course of and the Commission in the, at the beginning of the crisis, always this idea of financial stability was the main point, was the main objective of the of policies to be implemented. That was the main part of the agenda. And just after social consequences and so on. So basically, structural sensitivity, that is that. All the external agenda is imposed to the state, and what is this material infrastructure which filter this push from the outside. And of course, what you stressed about the power of big capitals versus the unions and so on, it participate in this ability too. Yes, there has been one question from the side, which was about one money and Greece. I think that, in fact, it's this idea that the behavior of Germany, of Schäuble, to kick out Greece of the euro was not consistent with the idea of building a one money. That's your point. I'm not sure that is not consistent from the point of view of Schäuble. You have to think as Schäuble. For Schäuble, the main point is to make the euro credible. And to make the euro credible, you have to stick to the rules. That's the more important point. The more important point is not the geography of the euro. The more important point is the rule linked to the functioning of this money in order to build its credibility. And in this case, to kick out Greece was a way to demonstrate how you are determined to make the rule applied, even if it's completely foolish and won't work. That's another debate. But from this perspective, I think that could be seen as rational as a way to try to implement world money. I think it won't work. That's not the point. But I think that the rationale is the following.
Okay, any questions? Okay.
I would like to ask you both for an opinion concerning the debate, the ongoing debate on the introduction of the so-called Eurobond. So, do you think there will ever be a political willingness to create them? Do you think they may actually be a solution to narrow this huge gap in the sovereign debts within the Eurozone? Just
one and the German one. The French one, it will be a solution out in order to mutualize the present indebtedness and try to recover autonomy in debt in order to launch growth. And for the German, let's keep the house in order to control the budget, to see if the people are wise, and then 1 or 2 decades ahead, we have robots. And so the same proposal, but totally opposite vision. For one, it is the crowning of a kind of federalization. For the French, it is a pragmatic tool in order to overcome and to reduce the burden of the debt. And again, it was blocked. I have been part of it. I've been signing for this, but without any hope, because the Germans do control this element. And they don't want to add mutualization of the risk and so on. So we mutualize, we will trust you. And it will take a lot of time for the French to be trusted by the German. So clearly, let's see. We are young enough. Maybe you will see Rubens, but I probably will not. I not responded to the East. Good. The good thing is that finally, you institute a kind of order, which is very interesting. When I compare Russia, Soviet Union and Russia, and Poland. Poland is very much better than Russia, first because they have no oil, they have no Putin, and they try to benefit from acquis communautaire in order to guide a little bit the reform, instead of the Big Bang, which was, in a sense, integration. You have structural funds and so on. So, element, it was a good point. And last, clearly it rebuilds European geographic territory. The big concern is that you have two contradictions, north-south, north-east, and I fear that in the long run. The East, imagine you have a anti-Putin, I say Russia and so on, you have a complete recomposition. It was the plan of Mr. Angela Merkel to ally to Russia in those allies. And look how little enthusiastic has been when Mr. Sarkozy, we're too young, proposed to, that the German join the Euro Mediterranean. They don't care so much. So clearly, in a sense, it was a very good example of the ability to have a smooth transition. But on the other side, it makes political bargaining more difficult because they've been catching up, they modernize, capital go directly. And on the contrary, they for example, Portugal is suffering from the fact that industrialization is going east, not south. So you have conflicts of specialization, and it makes compromise more difficult. And again, it makes the British scenario more viable. Again, to have this contradiction, they cannot share exactly the same model. So why not to have a downgrading of the ambitions? No question for you, from you, so you probably have. No, you're the organizer?
I'm part of the organizer. We will discuss later on. Something. Okay. One
more. Hi. From what I read in the article they provided us, I couldn't really understand what's the reason for the southern countries to join the European Union, if it was a political idea that only stabilizing the prices would be beneficial, or avoiding volatility of exchange rate would be very beneficial for the country, or if it was an ideology that those things were maybe more important than appreciating the currency or having to flexibilize the labor market and other measures that... Yeah, what's the reasons for them?
I've been living this period. You will go out of dictatorship, and then the way is to adopt democracy, general principle, and economic modernization. So the exchange rate was more detailed. So it's a big move. Europe was supposed a modernization process in the sense of sociological one. You have obsolete structure, and therefore you have a global appetite for this because it was the way opening again to transnational exchange and so on. And the small details of exchange rate was not that important. Let me give you an example. Why Helmut Kohl decided one Ostmark equals one Dutch mark, which was a big mistake. The idea is that we have emerged, we have to be equal, and in the symbol, we cannot say, for example, a shifting exchange rate between Ostmark, because it will mean it's not reunification. So in a sense, in this case of Spain, Portugal, we join modernity, and we see later on the economic problem raised. And again, it's again economicism. It was not a purely economic point of view, it was a political point of view. The elite wanted to join. And then the capital used it. So it was not the capitalists in Spain saying we want the euro. Of course they are present, but it was a political move, both shared by the socialists and by social democrats. And then you have the economic consequences. Okay, but it was not determinant. For example, you are right again. I imply in my bad wording that the name of the game is euro stabilized exchange rate. No, it was the formal way to present it. But it was extraversion, I totally agree with you. It was a small pretext. It was not at all the core argument. It was it was the only way to discuss it economically, but it was the coup de force you denounce. It was never my point that okay, it was the core. No. It was sometimes, oh yes, sometimes I take for granted commas, and sometimes it's me. So, and okay. Be careful. So I'm cutting, sir. And since I'm in a minority, I have to use many times to be understood in conference the language of the majority. If I start my own presentation, they say, this is crazy, this guy. Okay, what does he speak about? Accumulation of Russia, I met you. I had to prove that I can speak their language. Okay, and then I try to shift, and then it's not very coherent because I'm shifting from the doxa to my vision, and in between, maybe many people are lost. I hope you are more stimulated than lost.
Yeah, just I think on this question, that's a very, very important question, because right now, which is almost evident that Greece would have been less worse off without the euro in the past 2 years than right now. Still, people want to stay in the euro less than 1 year ago, but still there is an important part of the population who want to stick with the euro. So what? Why? That's not economic interest. That's symbolic. And that's very strong. That's very strong, this symbol of euro, that if you are a Greek, even a poor Greek, you have the same money as a German. You are in the same community, and this symbol is very strong and is blocking a lot of criticism of that. If you, I don't know if there is some Mexican here, but in Mexico, when people in Mexico joined the ALENA, which was a complete disaster for the country in the mid-90s, the main argument, which was very popular at that time, is that you will join the first world. You are going out of underdevelopment, you are joining the first world. And this kind of symbol are very powerful political way to capture the benevolence of the people. And it's difficult to deal with. You need to imagine other symbols, which is not so easy.
OK. One last question. No? Ah.
To Mr. Boyer, thank you for your presentation. I was just wondering, from the seven scenarios that you outlined in your presentation, which one do you think, for the future in the EU, which scenario is
nobody
Eurozone knows. Moving towards?
Nobody knows. It is my weakness.
Or
if I were post-Keynesian, I would say British, I would say neoclassical, Hayekian, I would say Schumpeterian, I would say I'm regressionist, and I think nobody knows.
Right.
Nobody knows. Because you have strategic moves. And again, I'm impressed by the strategic move of Angela Merkel. She was pro-nuclear, CC movement, from one day to another, she stopped. And this is open to innovation in history. And my argument is the following. You cannot, even with the banking union or the refinement, everything, supposing it is completed, this system is incoherent. Donc, you cannot, because the idea, we build progressive equivalent system and then the system go itself automatically. This will not happen. You have contradiction. And facing contradiction, you have the opening of the situation. Who will impose his vision? Cedric thinks that things are done. the capitalists are so strong that you are always... But you can face such contradiction that you cannot implement anymore. Imagine you have again mass unemployment. In a sense, you cannot focus the innovation. I'll give you an example. I've been studying carefully 30 years ago all the ideology in France in order to go out of the crisis of 29. I found planism, familialism, corporatism, colonialism. I found many, many communists. I never found Fordism. And nevertheless, you had the Fordist era. It makes you very modest. It makes you very, very modest. Because you have many, purchasing power theory in spite of Keynes, you have many theories. Nobody anticipated. Why? Because you have the Second World War. Was it a big social event in which you invent industrial policy, credit money, measuring inflation, indexing wages. You invented. You could not forecast from the past. So we should be very careful. And it is the big weakness of regulationists. If I'm neoclassical, I did my optimum model and so on, and I give you, this is the solution. I go to the TV, and I beat anything. I don't go to the TV because they will beat me, because I will criticize them, I can destroy their point. I cannot say this is the way out. For example, I've been writing two papers on Greece. It is mainly be careful, the plan will fail. I'm not entitled, I don't know how to have a solution for Greece, because the transition is such and so. I have no solution, it is my weakness. I can make the big, and I trust my analysis. I cannot dare, I say, and so on, be careful, the people. You have a determinist analysis of the past, and then you induce. In period of social crisis, you cannot do this. In the when we were in the 60s and so on, even May 68 in France was not so dramatic if you are looking from a regulationist point of view. Now, in the period today, you cannot anticipate. Look, the way financial markets do react to the Chinese crisis. They are uncertain about, is it a cyclical one? It is a pure financial one? It is the end of a regime? Is it the point? It is totally open. And all the vision, the financiers are divided. And therefore, then you have the structural selectiveness. You see the point? Out of this chaos, I think we'll develop some way. This is the direction. You cannot ex ante try to. Because capitalist economy are very complex. The interdependency are extraordinary. You discover with the crisis. You see, you have a real estate crisis in China, and then brutally, you exacerbate the crisis in Brazil, which exacerbates the Venezuela. You put in Russia, you put Saudi Arabia back to the shale gas in the US. And all this play in the macro accumulation of capital. It's not, there are no details. And nobody can ex ante. Because by definition, like in physics, you have strong non-linearities, you see. For example, when China and US was booming, oh, the world economy is stable. Now you have the problem, and you discover that the intrinsic instability of the world economy. You see, like, and the system has been the same. Simply, the analysts have been misreading as an equilibrium point, which was a contingent compatibility of evolution. You see the point? And the big danger is to interpret as a model, as an equilibrium, a thing which is simply a transitory compatibility. Or compossibility for the time of Bob Jessop and so on. So again, you should be very careful. It's nice to be deterministic, but be careful. You have reflexivity. For example, the financial markets are very reflexive. They believe something, they think something, and they really feedback. And this mechanism is very open to novelty. It's not determinist. I'll give you an example. Once upon a time, we have back in 1992. The financial market were very happy when unemployment was climbing, because then you have deflation, weakening of labor force. Ah, they speculate. And one day they discovered, my lord, with structural unemployment is very bad. And they speculate against by the fact that unemployment is too high, it's not viable. So governments have to spend the public, and therefore I think that we have inflation. Because the government will have to borrow in order to sustain. This shift cannot be detected. You see the point, no? You have a correlation between exchange rate and unemployment, and brutally the vision change, and the derivative is changing. It was impossible to detect, really. And you see the non-linearity. Imagine a little unemployment is a disciplinary device for workers. A huge unemployment is a threat to the stability. And how do you shift from one to another? So this is why I'm losing all the battles, because it's too complex. I was trained as a physicist, and nobody's perfect. Instead of the Newtonian mechanics, I would prefer to have physical nonlinear statistics and so on, so nonlinear physics. Which is very complex, but which opened. My argument is that you take China, US, and Europe, and you put them. You have possibility of chaos, of crisis, of debt. You have a wonderful set of regimes. And equilibrium is minimalist probability. But like you see the economists, they prefer to look at the very light house, because then we see quite well. But it is simply a very specific, unlikely case in the general case. And I think it is the big challenge to social science, to have sufficient complexity, but nevertheless some things that can be transmitted. So I hope I transmitted a little bit my methodology. And look on my website, for example, read my paper on Germany. You will see how it helps us to understand. And second, read all my papers on crisis, way out of crisis. Be careful, be careful. The way, real ways out of crisis has been the two world wars. And if you look carefully, Thomas Piketty, bestseller, it's not the victory of ID, it's not the victory of information, but it relates, but de facto, it was the Second World War. Yeah. No, really, they had to admit. It's very clear. And the poor theorization, my first thesis I've been supervising was, and it was a disaster because I was too young. the impact of world wars on regulation change, but it was very difficult to deal. Very, very difficult to deal. There are very few theories at that period. Okay.
Last question, or more? Last chance. Okay, so we will thank both presenters.